All right. Namaste, Kripadin Standi. With me is Satkriti for the last meeting and with Jayson. And today we'll be discussing Chutney music specifically in the various genres, the origins, the future, and the present.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Raj. Hi, Jayson. Good to meet you, Jayson.
Yes. I think we have spoken at length many times over the past months.
For like 1 year, we have, we have been in touch, but we were also planning for a collaboration, but with everything going on with COVID and situation, it's so it's good to meet Jayson.
Yeah. You know?
So it's nice to meet you at last. So Jayson, today's topic is as Chutney, and you have been working over Chutney as a performer. So could you tell about your detail that how you have related and how your ancestors were related to India and which generation you are from, which part if you know, and how Chutney develop in Caribbean island? Could you explain regarding this thing? Then I could share my research part.
Okay, great. So from the accent, you could tell that I am from Trinidad and Tobago, born and bred, where Chutney music was born. Historical reference, you could correct me if I'm wrong, I believe it's 187 years.
Yes.
75, but yes.
Yes, 75.
85 or 75?
170 approx, basically. It's started in 1845,
Cool. 75, usually, we say.
Right, so 175 years ago, when the Jahajis left, is it Uttar Pradesh and Bihar? And they came to the Caribbean. Obviously, they would have dropped pockets of Indians all over the world, Trinidad being one of them. Per capita, I would say, we would rival South Africa in terms of Indians in the country, because roughly 500,000 Indians, people of Indian descent, let's be correct, live in Trinidad and Tobago. And I think that could rival South Africa, who claims to be the biggest in the Indian diaspora catchment. So they took, just like everyone else, they took the classical instruments, the dolab, the dantal, and harmonium, right? And they brought it to Trinidad. And before we came on, is Raj is the name, right?
Yes.
Raj was saying the reference soca chutney, and he's quite correct. When our tan singing or local classical singing, as is referred to now, when it kind of mixed with these kind of Caribbean elements, they got a soca feel. So if you listen to normal tan singing and you listen to chutney, it sounds totally different, right? Totally different. And it has now become kind of soca-tized up deep. Even the Bollywood remixes, you would take a popular song like, let's say, Tujhe Kitna, Chahe Lagna, and how Bollywood romanticizes that kind of song to how we would portray that in the Caribbean or let's say Trinidad. It's totally different, you know? We always like this party upbeat, and that is essentially the what do we call that? The gist of how chutney is made. It's a kind of, it's upbeat, you know? A lot of soca.
It's like the history of chutney says that it was started as a folk song, and that folk song with the amalgamation of like African culture also, it turned into a chutney of a party style.
Well, chutney in itself means spicy, right? So we took the tansing in the folk song and we spiced it up, and we put our Latin percussions in it and it kind of swing. And we got this whole new, I would say, subgenre like Bollywood, per se. Well, not even.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. Totally get you. It was like that. So I basically, if you could let me know that how your interest got into this chutney, and have your, like, from your parents' side, someone was interested in chutney and they were working over chutney, and then from them you have started getting knowledge about chutney and you started working over this style? Because chutney plays a very important part among the diaspora community right now. As you know that I am working in London. Mm-hmm. So even in London community, chutney is something that they could relate themselves with, right. their Indian origin. So could you tell me that how that it's like inbuilt among the diaspora that, okay, we want to learn about chutney as it helps us to remember about cultural heritage, something like that? You and Raj could just tell me.
I'm not too sure if Raj want to go first.
You have to repeat the question. I'm sorry. I was talking to Vishal.
Raj.
And he'll pick up.
No, Raj, basically, I wanted to, from both of you now, that as I am working in London, as I told you, and chutney plays a very important part among the diaspora community to remember their heritage.
Yes.
So what is your experience regarding chutney? Like when you were, like, when you were young and when you were, like, you used to heard from your parents regarding the importance of chutney and how it has turned now. It's like something, it helped you guys to remain close to your cultural heritage?
Absolutely. It's a sense of a cultural identity. If people listen to chutney, you know that this is a West Indian family and it's a type of music where everyone can gather together. They'll hang out, gaff, lime, whatever word they may use. It was maybe even the center of the function that was happening, because around the music and dance floor, there's music, people talking, people drinking and things of that nature. The life of the party centered around music, and that's how it's always been. Mm-hmm. Even if you look at Gaon ke log, right? That's what happened to chutney. And of course, it's because it's surrounded by various cultures, it absorbed those various cultural traits. And with time, it also absorbed, as you said, an agglomeration of different characteristics. So, but each country is a little bit unique as to how their chutney is. That's my experience growing up.
That's a really interesting part which you have raised, Raj. Jayson, can you tell me that chutney differ from different island, like Caribbean island consists of most of the place. So chutney in Trinidad differs from chutney in Guyana and chutney in like Jamaica. Is it different?
Okay.
Those people perform different kind of chutney in different islands.
To answer the question that Raj had answered before, because this will explain a lot of why I do what I do in the chutney music space. So you're quite correct. Family. I came from a working class family. I make that reference because most of the persons who like or love chutney are working class, I would say. My family, as Raj was saying, the gatherings were kind of signatured by the presence of chutney. If chutney wasn't there, so from a little guy, he had chutney, he had the Devanagafus and whatever. And it's as Raj was alluding, it's a kind of euphoria you're thinking about, you know, dining with your aunties and uncle, obviously they would be drinking, right? You with your cousins, chutney palasing, people dancing. And Raj is correct, it does build a sense of community, hence the reason why chutneymusic.com, which we will talk more in later on in the interview, has been so successful today. The second question, how does it differ? I think Raj would have also alluded to that, in that everyone put their unique spin to it, because a Trinidadian listening to Baita Ghana from Suriname would be like, hey, that's chutney, you know? Trinidadian listening to Guyana and Trinidad, same, right? Similar.
Yes.
Guyanese, for the record, and please no one don't shoot me if anybody have Guyanese affiliations. Guyanese love Bollywood. They love Bollywood, chutney ties, Bollywood songs. They love that.
Oh, that's a hit right now. That one CD. Kasam say.
Yeah, I think that will be remixed from now until I take my leave of this world. Guyanese, they love Bollywood. My grandmother. My mother-in-law is Guyanese, and when we have our Chutney shows, she's be like, bleh. But when you have the Bollywood, she's like, oh, this is my song, and this kind of Nagara music, I would think that is close to Tassa in a way, because of the percussional tones. I can identify with it as a Trinidadian, and I do listen to a lot of Chutney, by the way, that's for the record, a lot, from bad to worse to good ones. Even this new subgenre they call Bollini, which is taking the Bollywood songs and chutneyizing them, you know. Even, and that is a big hit with Diane.
No, that's great. That's great. Like how with the change in time, the music is also changing, because what I was going and reading through my work, it was like mostly when they have started Chutney, it usually consists folk songs. And now you are saying that even Bollywood is playing a very important part. So I think Bisham can and you go ahead, Jason. Saying something.
I would say if we say Bollywood is influencing probably easily over 75% of the current Chutney songs.
Fiji also does that a lot too. With Fiji, it's mainly Bollywood songs, and they will reggae. They will absorb a lot of reggae influences into their genre of music.
I've seen that in the Netherlands as well. They have a particular swing, so it's like Baita Ghana, because this is where Bisham was giving me the history that most of the people in Netherlands, they came from Suriname.
It's like that, what I have seen through the videos also and work also in past, they use proper folk songs in Chutney music, like Kali Kothariya Ma Bite Nahi Ratiya, the songs which were written at that time by the Indian diaspora. But now they have started using Bollywood more. So Visham, could you say something about the history, that how it has changed from folk culture?
I want to continue of the points that Jason would have mentioned. So yes, each diaspora is unique. One thing I want to mention with regard to the evolution or the birth of Chutney music, which came in the latter part of the 1900s, is it followed the pattern of our local calypso here, right? And the local calypso did undergo similar changes in an earlier period. So the original calypsos were not in English, they were in Antillean Creole, we call it Trinidad Pato. Jason and I had a conversation regarding that, and then just like Hindustani music, it went over into Trinidad English Creole, because the standard or the lingua franca had changed in the Caribbean. On the point of influence from India and Indian films, the first film to come to Trinidad was Bala Joban, which was in the 1940s. After that, there was a flood of it's now Bollywood, but prior to that, it was just called Indian films. It was a huge influence then on the expressions in the diaspora. Prior to the 1940s, I want to mention during indentureship, Logit was the most popular, especially the Sanskar Geets. But after indentureship ended and Indians were able to move between estate to estate, whenever you have free movement of people, you get the discussion among people, and well, the geniuses come out and you get a renaissance or something, or a birth of something new. So when we look into the 1920s, what was born was a local classical, dancing in Guyana and Baita Ghana. It would be around obviously different periods, but in Trinidad it was 1920s. Until the 1940s it was Bala Joban, and then the influence of Indian films. And then in Trinidad we went through a phase called Saj, Saj meaning band, especially the bands with the trumpets and the percussion instruments, where now these bands called Saj, as being decorated, would now start playing the same Indian songs. Around the time of Sundar Popo, that is when, and that's what I want to mention, because the expression, the local expressions of the Creole population had to reinvent itself after Calypso, to gain sway in the mainstream. So it went from calypso to soca. In the same way, in Trinidad, the Martikor songs we spoke of earlier, and the Batuan songs, and the Biaha songs, eventually got a new, or this is a renaissance with Sundara Popo, and started having up-tempo. What I also want to mention, I can't vouch for Suriname or Guyana, but a lot of our local traditions, local expressions here has a lot of Spanish beats in it because we're so close to Latin America. Okay. If you listen to soca and calypso, I could easily sing Latin music to that. If I sing it in that melody in Spanish, it sounds Latin America. And I think that had a huge influence on chutney music, because chutney music is a renaissance in the sense of the old traditions, Lalana Kusi, Bahi Nananari, which is a sohat, by Sambo Drum, became a chutney because it became up-tempo and it started to adapt to the Caribbean beats. So that's something very unique about chutney music. It is really a renaissance of the Sanskar beat slash Lok beat tradition with a new beat of expression. That's one. And then the other thing is that these three happened in the Caribbean in separate countries around the same time. Not necessarily in isolation, because there was a lot of migration between Trinidad, Guyana, Suriname, Guyana, and vice versa. It exists now, but not as much, not so much from Suriname. But so there were actually competitions, whether it be in Lokgeet or local classical, from people in Trinidad. People come from Guyana and Suriname, and then people from Trinidad would go to Guyana and Suriname would go there. So there were set up competitions, and that is very important to note that, because that was a period of the birth of chutney music and the revival of local classical, right? That's just a brief history. Yeah. A brief history of specifically North Indian Caribbean tradition within the 1900s. Now, as Jayson said, yes, everything is Bollywood. A lot of people, old people and some young people now, I want to recognize one guy, Madan Makoon, who had set up a website. There are those practitioners, and I could call some names, in Trinidad, Vijay Ramkisoon, Ravi Jagrup, Nirmala Sisnarain. There's three that I know personally, and they're young people, but it's very few. Most of the young people and the product that is of high demand in Trinidad, like Jason said, in Guyana, is Bollywood. A lot of young people associate with the Bollywood, but I want to mention that chutney music, yes, is their pride as well, but there is a distinct difference in identity of the expression in Bollywood versus chutney. What I want to add to that quickly is that now we see a resurgence of Bhojpuri song traditions in Bollywood. I remember Aladdin, which Ore Sawariya Sasur Ghajana, which is a local classical song here. And then there are new ones like Badri Ke Dulhania, I think it is. But more and more now we see a crossing over where now these, they might know it's Bhojpuria, because I mean, with the current move of Indian nationalism and Indian identity from India, there's no distinction between Punjabi or Bhojpuria or Gujarati. Anything that is Indian comes out of India by the standards of an Indo-Caribbean person, specifically my experience in Indo-Trinidadian, it's Indian, and that's who I am. So even if it's a Punjabi folk song like Odhai Dinana Javani Nara Chaladi, I mean, any person of Indian origin in Trinidad knows that song by Jagjit Singh, which is a Punjabi folk. So again, that tells of the influence where our identity is now absorbed or is diluted in the context of now being so heavily influenced by the Indian film industry as well as the Indian song industry, which we now have access to more so latter part of 1900s and well after 2000.
That was really good explanation regarding the history part. What I wanted to know about Visham and Jason, I think you both can explain regarding this thing about the history and present, about the role of women in chutney music, mm-hmm. and how they have carried that folk culture to the present time when it has amalgamated different style. So, Jayson, can you tell us a little bit about the role of women in present world of chutney music? And are they singing the folk music also with the traditional chutney music?
Okay. I'll let Visham explain that part because we have spoken about that in detail. What I would say to offer something new, Chutney would have started predominantly with women, right?
It was started with women.
It started with women, and in fact, Sundar Popo, he got a lot of heat when he started to sing some of these songs, and well, he's now the pioneer of Chutney, right? As it is now, we are seeing, sadly so, women are becoming like an endangered species in Chutney music, Chutney soca, whatever. There are very few women in the space, and that is sad. In my opinion, that is very sad. I believe it is because of the patriarchal setup of the industry. They have not nurtured that aspect of making a way for women. I have always said this, and I'm sure this will get a lot of views when I say this. A certain competition that we all very well know has been in operation for 25 years. Not once mm-hmm. has a woman ever won that competition. And that says a lot about either the quality of the woman or the quality of the competition. And I'll hand it over to Visham to give you the real breakdown of Jupati and all this kind of thing.
I just wanted to add one thing. You have explained it beautifully, that as you mentioned with the history, it was women who have started Chutney music, and they used to sit and they used to sing a folk culture, and suddenly it turned into Chutney music with bringing different beats and music. So in present time, even if one and two women are singing Chutney music, are they properly following the folk music, or they are using the Bollywood style Chutney, as you explained?
Wow,
that's a good question.
I'm gonna get in a lot of trouble now, but I will speak my mind.
I could say it, Jason. You go ahead, but I could say without reservation, but you go ahead.
Okay. Now, we're going in Bollywood versus traditional Chutney and what is considered Chutney Soka, right? Okay. So let's make some small definitions. Visham, he's looking like he's anxious to jump in, right?
No, you go ahead. I just enjoy the conversation.
This is going to be, as my pause reason right now, right? Okay, simplistic definitions. Chutney music, we consider the prevalent use of Hindustani language, that is chutney, right? Or what we refer to now as traditional chutney. Chutney soca is a derivative of chutney, in where the language is different. Much more use of English. Now, there's this genre called Bollini or Bollywood chutney, Bollywood remix, and Bollywood cover is something separate, right? So Bollini is where you take the melody of the Bollywood song, the popular Bollywood song, sing it over in English, chutneytize it, and put out a song. So in the space of traditional chutney, by no stretch of the imagination, there's a young lady by the name of Himlata Dindial, called the woman with the power voice. In my opinion, she is the most relevant right now. There's her sister Rafika and a couple of others, but when you talk about real real power, I would say Himlata Dindial. In the Chutney Soka space, the first name that comes to mind is Kavita Ramkisoon. She has been around for a while, and she, in the last 2 to 3 years, her marketing is beautiful, right? In the realm of Bollywood, I wouldn't even say Bollini, because she doesn't do Bollini, right? in the world of Bollywood, I would say Satkriti Sinha is arguably the best Bollywood singer in terms of popularity and what you would call that, ability to project. So there are people within the space, but from my view as a, I don't want to say gender affairs advocate, but I would like to see more, and I would hand it over to more women in the space. I hand it over to Visha.
All right, I just want to highlight that ChutneyMusic.com, the definitions Jayson gave is actually work by ChutneyMusic.com, because I mean, when Jayson had reached out to me, one of the issues we discussed is that there's no actual definition. Right. What is chutney music? What is chutney suka? What is chutney parang?
What okay, is just interject one here. And before you remind me of something. When we tried to make these definitions, it was met with a lot of friction. So thank you for reminding me about that. But you see, again, with any person who's trying to shape the industry, they would meet a lot of friction because, hey, who's this man? Coming in or whatever, you know? And Bisham, you can continue from there.
But it's important to note, because the competition Jayson had alluded to is that, I mean, I had asked the question, okay, so you have judges. One issue I had regarding that, because Jayson had mentioned what style it is in, and I think it was a revival of, and this is where Hemlata comes in, a revival of traditional chutney where the songs are sung in Hindustani. But the other issue is that the language is not something, I mean, the judges themselves, do they know the language? Even judge it. The other point I want to bring across is that what is the definition of chutney suka? If you don't have a definition, how can you judge it? And that's the point we had made. Mm-hmm. And even asking questions from the organization of that particular competition, we met with no answers as to what the definition is. So I'm even wondering if I would enter the competition, if I would know exactly what the score sheet would have and what I have to look at. And that is where definitions are important. Now, yes, I wouldn't say chutney music. What I would say about the whole issue of gender, women carried on what we call a Lokgita Sanskar tradition from indentureship period into post-indentureship. So that a lot of the songs you would hear, especially in chutney, is from a woman's perspective. Around the time of Sundara Popo, that is where we kind of, you or the marker we use for when chutney came in. I want to say that chutney music was a response to the racial discrimination.
It was like, just sorry to disturb you. I just wanted to add the history. Like chutney music, as you mentioned, right? It was against the racial discrimination, and it was a way of creating a unity among the community which was present, because they needed something to unite them. And well, at that time, chutney developed.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't say unite, as it was a driving force or a recipe devised by, well, I would say Sundara Popo identifies, because before him, the national stage of Trans-Tobago at least had no expression from the Hindustani of Trans-Tobago.
Exactly.
After chutney, it became mainstream. So I believe it was a reinvention or rebranding of the expression of the Indian diaspora. So it could be now seen as something that could be a commodity in mainstream, right?
Which time
thing is that Jason's point, after this period, all of a sudden, it was dominated by males, because males were very prevalent. I do want to highlight that there were also females, less so, like Auntie Lily John, Molly Ramcharan, Rasika Dindial. These are popular names with local classical and even chutney and folk songs. Lily Ram John sings Sanskar Geets. Down to that tradition, there's also Rewati Ali in Debe, people I would have interviewed, and they were very prominent. So yes, that issue of sexism was there. You tend to now find males singing these songs, which were obviously from a a female perspective.
Written by female. Most of the songs, as you correctly mentioned, were written by females.
But it's important for us to highlight that, because you have to remember in the English-speaking diaspora, Guyana and Trinidad, the Hindustani descendants or the descendants of the Indians don't understand the song. So little do they know that this is a man singing a song from a woman's perspective. For instance, this song, Raat Ke Sapna Dikhaye Piya Humko Raat Ke Sapna from Ramdev Chaitu. He's male, but is a woman singing about basically a dream she had last night, explaining to her beloved and saying that, well, she was without her, she was without her brother-in-law, she was without her brother, she was without any name tree in
the
yard.
Or even the popular one, Babana Abijal.
No, Babana Abijal is a different one. That actually mocks the Brahmin, because the word Baban
is Brahmin. Yes.
So, but again, it's from a woman's perspective. You're very correct.
One of the famous
Chutney music, like it's among the in the history. I don't know where people know right now, but it's one of the famous song. Kali Kotharia Ma Biti Nahi Ratiya Ta Kiske Bataye Ham Peera Re Bidesia. This was written by women, but it was sung by a male. It was basically, it is difficult to pass the night in dark cell. To whom, O Bidesia, can I tell my ordeal? So it is the perspective of women, but was sung by a male.
Again, our example. Ham Na Jaybe Sasur Ghar Me Baba. So again, all the popular ones we're talking about is basically from a woman's perspective. And I want to mention, Jayson is very right with the competition you mentioned. Because he had asked every woman if they do Bollywood or whatever. I find, I don't know if it's just me or probably it's biased, but most of the women who come in, they actually stick to, or it's like a renaissance again of not a woman trying to reclaim what was originally theirs. It could be that. But clearly, there's a male domination with regard to Chutney and so.
Also, I think a link between the switching from a female to it being sung by males has to do a lot with Londa as well, because a lot of these songs were sung by Londa, right? And that could also be kind of the transitional force from being sung by females to strictly males, because many of these songs were sung by Londas, especially in the 60s and 70s.
Fair enough. Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Sure.
One thing, Visham, which I wanted to confirm, that whether in present times, the women who are singing Chutney are still following some traditional songs, like the lyrics which I have told you, the Bhojpuri lyrics.
Yeah.
They have totally transformed into Bollywood Chutney.
No, because people still stick to the Matikorwa as well as the Bhatwan and so. So there are like Auntie Rukmini, I must mention, Rukmini Bipat, that's Bodhram Hulas' sister. She actually does it as a job. So people hire her to come and sing at weddings. As well as Auntie Rewati, who's from Debe, and Auntie Lily John. I call them Auntie because I know all them personally, because they are our resource and we meet on a regular basis. But this is where it hasn't changed. In other words, these names I mentioned would sing the song as we know it during indentureship and post-indentureship, before the 1940s, when Bala Jovan came and Indian films influenced our expressions in Hindustani. So it still exists, and it exists so much that it is a different brand from Chutney music. Mind you, they might have common roots. Just like me, a person of Indian origin, and you, a citizen of India, have common roots, we are a completely different identity. In the same way, now these Lokgeet songs, Chutney music, Chutney Soka, all being from similar roots, are separate identities or expressions from the Indian diaspora. Yeah.
I totally understand. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, Visham. Yeah. You were telling about how that.
So Raj and I, when we just came back shortly, so I identified Sonar Popo and Sonar Popo singing of songs by women, but there was also another factor of force that pushed Chutney not only in the national stage of Trinidad and to be mainstream in Guyana and Suriname, but also internationally.
Nationally, yes.
Was Kanchan and Babla. husband and wife team.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Come to the Caribbean, and then they started singing over the songs of Drupadi, Ramdev Chaitu, Sundar Popo, and even changing the words. Because one thing I want to mention is that, and I say it because I'm an advocate for language, is that among the artists, even in Suriname, there occurs mispronunciations in the original lyrics, right? Might occur less in Suriname, but it does occur. And Trinidad more so because the language was lost. Kanchan was a speaker of Hindustani. So what I realized in listening to her songs, the lyrics changed. Like this song goes, Abana Jaybe Baburu Barme Katwa. Right? These are set line like all Bhojpuri songs. Ohi Baburu Barme Pargail Hindulana Sasur Jilawe Sasurwake Jira Jargail Hamar. And it changes to Sun Sasur to
Bisham, I gotta interrupt you for a second because I'm sure some people may be curious too. What came first, the filmy song or her song?
What came first?
That particular song.
Obviously.
This particular song is typically from our folk tradition. So Sundar Popo sang that initially. I honestly believe that song originally would have come from Suriname. I mean, at this point it's very difficult because this research has not been done because there's so much communication among these three countries with these most significant population or descendants of indentured laborers, where we can't identify where the original source was because we hear all the same songs in the three places. This song in particular is a Bhojpuri song, so it comes from our tradition. What I've noticed is that the songs the women used to sing, we come back to this point. The song traditions as well as the language, Hindustani spoken by indentured laborers in the three different nations, which we mentioned and we're focusing on Suriname, Guyana, Trinidad, is similar yet different because it also depended on the period of start and end of indentureship, which would coincide with particular recruitment areas. Across the indentureship period, the British had moved from Jharkhand all the way up to eastern Uttar Pradesh in the recruitment recruitment period. So that there is a move of the language from that Sadhani Bhojpuri all the way up to Awadhi, that's stretching that region. And of the two countries, Suriname started the latest, so their language is a bit different. Again, that also tells of the songs, because sometimes, even though I hear or know a song from Trinidad and trace it back to Suriname, when I go to Suriname, I hear songs that I never heard in Trinidad. So, two reasons for that. As well as the fact that the language is still alive in Suriname. So, if the language is still alive, it means the people would know more of the traditional songs, right? But again, I can't really say because I don't know what transpired before that. Language was very much alive and the songs in the three countries. So I can't really say.
Okay, in Suriname today, there are a lot of people that are composing as well. A lot of people are composing in Holland and Suriname.
That's good. With the language, I want to ask that, as you mentioned regarding the importance of language, in most of the folk songs here, like even during Mati Khor or even while the women are sitting and singing folk songs, it's many of the songs are full of erotism and sensualism. So if that thing is present in the Chutney lyrics right now, what about Jayson?
Jayson can attest.
One more thing that with those words, like particular Bhojpuri words, or you have changed those word and new words for erotism and sensuality, have added that.
I want, just before Jason goes, okay, so let's take a new song that came out, and this whole thing about new composition. This is not a new composition, but the artist clearly knew the meaning because there was, and Jason and I were really conversing around this time because we use the expression, we was one chicken fire. Because we had challenged them to say, why? This is, we call something called pikong, right? Pikong is tit for tat, is gali, right? It exists in a Trinidad space, not only in Indian space, but outside. One wonders where original source would have come from, but we haven't done that research. There's this song that goes, it's Jisam, how it goes again?
Gunga Gana.
Yeah, Gunga Gana, right? Gunga Gana, which is a song that was done by Dubraj Prasad. And there was, so this is no different from the past, as far as I could see, based on my research. There were constant wars that was, the battles were in galleys among local classical singers. So I was very amazed when I saw this tit for tat or pikong between two artists in Trinidad. Again, it's like coming from two gharanas, because the Dindyal family is like a gharana, and the Dubraj is another gharana. That's one tradition I want to mention that exists, is that just like we have when we spoke of the caste system and it being passed down from father to son, the singing tradition was also something that's passed on from father to children. Rasika Dindyal comes from a prominent singing family. So that's Dubraj. And what I have noticed is that all the people I interact with, even the two names I mentioned, the Sisnarains, Vijay Ramkisun and Ravi Jagrup, who are younger than me, they come from gharanas. So they come from, and we have a gharana system or had one in Trinidad. They come from singing families, which were very, I mean, it was like a caste per se, but as a profession, where my father was a singer, so I carry on the tradition. It wasn't so much a caste to accept inferiority, superiority, because as we expressed in these interviews, the ability to sing in Hindustani was a way to hold on to what your identity was. And these people did this very well. So much so that it was not a matter of carrying on a caste, but more a legacy of a family.
Okay.
A crude song, a song that we can mention maybe is, like you mentioned, Gungan, but maybe Namange Koreli Choka.
Okay, yes. Now,
that's so also, when we're talking about eroticism?
Yes, it does, because it talks about, this is a common thread, and this is, I think, what Satkriti is referring to. So, basically, the husband is away, earning money. The Dewar is much younger and may necessarily be at home. And there were flirtations between these two people, the brother-in-law and the Bahu, the Dulhan, Dulhania, Dulahen. That's what the word we use for daughter-in-law in Trinidad. It's not Bahu. My nani used to call her daughter-in-law Dulahen, Bahu. Right?
Dulhen is basically
that. She said, hey, Dulahen. Why are you doing? So she used Dulahen in the sense of she accepted this as the Dulahen of her son, but still referred to as Dulahen, meaning sister-in-law. I'm sorry, daughter-in-law. So that flirtations between these two family members, which is seen as taboo, is something that is highlighted over and over again in Bhojpuri. And this Mange Kareli Ke Chokha song is actually now between the father-in-law and the daughter-in-law.
Yes.
When the son was there, because the last line says, well, I don't know where you are, my beloved, but I'm not sure even I could keep my virginity for you. I mean, that is so explicit in the lines of what took place. And this is a common theme among Bhojpuri songs that I would even notice in translating songs or Lokgeet from Trinidad.
Yeah. I will start now. In terms of eroticism in the music, I don't think it could really be perceived as that, because these are societal norms. These things do happen, you know. Yes, they would sing about, is it Radhe, Krishna, whatever, in the beginning. They were singing devotional songs to God, right? And then all of a sudden, how do we go from that to, I don't want to eat your karani choka, you know, or whatever. So I wouldn't say eroticism, but yes, it is prevalent. What we are seeing now in modern day songs is move away from provocative stuff and move into certain stereotypes. And the music is now very heavily stereotyped as rum and horn songs. So horn is what we understand infidelity, right? So a lot of songs promulgating or promoting infidelity. I don't want my wife, I want to go and drink with my friends. This is what
Ivan wants to commit adultery against my partner.
These songs has gone, degenerate, has degenerated from devotion to the Lord, and then they were talking about erotic stuff in Bhojpuri. Now they are saying a lot of even more suggestive stuff in English, right? Promoting alcohol abuse, well, use, because abuse is subjective, right? Alcohol use, infidelity, and this comes back to the breakdown in society. So basically, they are projecting how society has evolved, and this is what we are seeing. From my standpoint, and I can't speak for the others, right? From my standpoint, even that song, that Karelli song that you guys were speaking about, that is still clever in a sense, you know, the double entendre of the song. But, and that is something that they would see in Calypso, what have you, right? But now it's so crass. It's like the art of writing, composing, is very watered down, if not lost.
That's great. Yeah.
I wouldn't say watered down. Because at the end of the day, if I look back to Radha Krishna Ras Lila songs, the reference to phallic symbols as a pichikari, the reference to, you see, you have to understand Indian philosophy or Eastern philosophy's perspective on sex is different from Western philosophy.
We didn't see it as taboo.
Philosophy is taboo, yes. But it's commonplace to express yourself. Just like we had said, the whole issue of, we spoke in the second interview about same-sex relationships. Before the imposition of our Western/Christian society, we were more liberal in our expressions,
yeah,
because our perspective was a bit different. Indian Eastern philosophy sees sex or the act of copulation as a union with God and the devotee. And
that is why Kama Sutra and Tantra, that's like a big thing for them, and we like, hey, that's been around for like donkey years. And people who have studied Kama Sutra, they even have a lot of more suggestive stuff inside there that doesn't even, that lends itself to modern day society.
How explicit could I be on this interview? Because there's one,
we may have viewers under 18.
Yeah. Okay. What I want to say is this. I have had conversations with people who would have done in-depth research on the Caribbean Hindustani language. Moti Marhe is our good friend. It's good that for Caribbean Hindustani, all the people who did research, we know them personally, so we could call up on the phone on a daily basis. Moti had compiled proverbs for a book called 500 Prekwerd, which is Dutch for 500 proverbs in Hindustani. And I spoke to Moti on the phone because they had asked him for what he had. He was like, Visham, there's some that I didn't give, you know. And when he told me the meaning on the phone, I mean, it what Jason's speaking about is explicit. This is 10 times more explicit.
Yeah.
So I what I want to say is that, honestly, within the world of the Indian diaspora, such being so explicit sexually is nothing new. And it goes back to the conversation we had earlier, that colonialism, indentureship, was based on an imposition of a different perspective.
That's what, if you go through the songs which our ancestors have written in Bhojpuri, it was full of erotism and sensualism. They never shy away. They use folk culture. Folk culture still use that thing, and that's why they have started isolating folk culture, because in their, like, the if you call the elite class, even in India, the elite class have started isolating folk culture because they are not ready to accept, which was always their tradition.
Right.
They are not ready to accept that tradition, which was always their tradition.
Colonialism.
Right, I'm not sure. I can't remember, Vishen, but I think there's a week where I know in Guyana I've seen it, where couples are supposed to be very close to each other,
The Karacho or something.
So what is that called, right? And then usually I see that because the windows are down in Guyana.
Karacho. Yeah, Karacho.
But for 1 week, though, the men and women are together.
I'm not sure the same festival, because the other thing is, remember, Bhojpuri traditions is not necessarily the same as in India in general.
I do remember saying that.
But if it's a week though, I'm not so sure if it's a week.
That's off topic. I'm sorry.
No, but I want that's a good point you brought up, Raj, because then we talk about Savariya and Sautan or Savatiya. Again, these are Bhojpuri words. One means a wife or beloved or the person you're committed to, the other means the mistress.
Yeah, mistress.
So, and that is that those are common words used in Bhojpuri folk again, which is very taboo in mainstream, Western expression. When we look at the movie Kalank, remember we spoke of that, there was a clear Sautan and Savariya, isn't it? Because the Savariya was having cancer and she chose a co-wife so that when she's no longer there, that this person would take over her role. So one looks again at the circumstance and situation of male-female ratio, circumstance and situation regarding economy, politics, and even the perspectives of the indentured laborers, which was different.
I think it would be a last question because we are like more than 1 hour we have. So last question would be like Visham and Jayson and Raj for all of you three, like, what translation have you seen? Have you seen the importance of chutney in carnival festival? Is chutney play an important role in carnival festival? And how it helps diaspora to connect with carnival festival?
So let me, I'll represent Suriname here, right? In Suriname, I haven't seen it because the carnival is not big over there. Mainly, it's for the people of African descent. So the Indians don't participate in any magnitude in Suriname.
Kiti Kuketa Kuta, I can't remember what it is. Name of the festival.
Conche.
Okay.
All right. So we're coming back again to this identity issue, right? Yes, chutney music plays a very big part of carnival, because if I am a person of Indian descent, and even other, we will call that, descents in Trinidad, chutney is much more accepted. songs like, Ram Singh Sharma by Omar Dutt Maraj. Yeah. These songs have crossed over and gone even into Jamaica, which is a bit,
not so mainstream.
Yeah.
And now it is mainstream in Jamaica, but Indian culture is not so mainstream in Jamaica.
Yeah.
So
and if you make it in Jamaica carnival, yeah, you will get through, as we say in Trinidad, right? So the Indians, when they are partying, most of them, they identify with the chutney. The Africans, they dance to it as well. So it does play a very big part of chutney. Hence the reason why chutneymusic.com has come into fruition. Because if you have a appreciation for statistics, like I do, I'm seeing chutney songs rivaling Bollywood songs in terms of views on YouTube. And this is a phenomenon of sorts for me. I said, wait, chutney clearly at a stage where it's ready to blow. The marketing of chutney, therefore, is another, that may be a whole topic for another
discussion. Mm-hmm.
But to answer your question, chutney music is a big part of Canada.
I just want to agree with Jayson. There is some change at this point in time. With Ricky Jai's Mortor, because Mortor was started with chutney music, started to come up on carnival performance on his stages. And yes, with Ram Singh Sharma. What I do think though, as Trinidadians, at least I can speak as a Trinidadian, not as a Suriname or Guyanese, is that not only among the descendants of indentured laborers, but the identity of Trinidadian is always seen secondary, something else that is promoted on mainstream media.
Right. Like in cricket.
And the other thing is, again, that stems because as people of Indian origin, we Trinidadian as well. So it even stems to ours, because remember, there's a different a step down again, because even though we fight for the space through Chutney, we're still not, or at least the expression of the Indian diaspora in Trinidad is not so mainstream. It has been cropping up, and I must say ChutneyMusic.com had a lot to do with that. What I want to also say is that I could start speaking Hindustani, and you wouldn't know if I'm from Suriname. As an Indo-Trinidadian, I could vacillate identities. I have always said this, people, because they fight for this issue of unity, they want to shy away from that topic. But my own personal experience is that I grew up in a Hindu home that was basically rural. My grandfather had cows. We used to leap. My nanny used to cook seke roti and chulha. She used to make adouri and things like that, which a person of my age may not have. I don't think there are much people my age who know of that. A generation before me, yes. So I grew up that, and I knew that as my identity as a young child. But when I turned 5 and had to go to school, I was brought up Presbyterian. And then I went to the University of West Indies. I find that as an Indo-Caribbean person, I have to vacillate between identities to be accepted in different spheres and spaces. In Trinidad and Tobago, because there are some people, and I say this without reservation,
Indo-Caribbean,
conveniently for politics, but if they're in a space which is quote unquote a mainstream space, they shy away from identity because they are afraid of it. To some extent, that's unconscious in me too, because if you play in Indian music, despite the fact that we have over 10 Indian Hindustani radio stations here, Indians tend to play it loudly when by themselves, but if they go in a mainstream space, that has now changed with ChutneyMusic.com and initiatives now. Because so much so, I think within the last decade, it is more accepted as Trinidadian to express your Indianness. That changed only in the last 10 years. That's my personal opinion.
And again, it stems from the marketing, right?
Yes.
You're quite correct, Visham, because you missed out earlier when I said I came from a working class family, and my Indianness or my love of chutney is, well, it have this saying of Dongtong and Uptong, right? Uptong is the hip people, and Dongtong is the grassroots coolie type people, right? So chutney has been seen as a lower class offering, right? And that is why I'm specifically said I came from a working class family. So because if you identify with chutney music in 2020, you're kind of stereotyped to be like, I beat my wife, or I was drinking rum all day and night, right? Yeah. So chutneymusic.com comes in now and says, hey, whoa, wait, hold on. I came from a working class family. I'm now arguably working middle or business, right?
Yeah.
And I love chutney. Do you love chutney? Yes, I love chutney too. Now, this renaissance, yes, we keep using that word renaissance. This renaissance now, so we make it like, hey, it's cool to like chutney. And this is where the Trinidadianness is going up, and the Indianness is kind of simultaneously being carried with it, because Bollywood is loved by most Indians. So it's cool to like Bollywood, but the it's quite correct. The chutney people are be like, yeah, I like chutney, you know. But if they are around the cool people, soca or whatever, and it's because of the marketing. It is because of the marketing. Now that ChutneyMusic.com has shown that, hey, this is a viable thing, this is a cool thing, this is the in thing. Now everybody, all of a sudden jumping out of the closet, oh, I love chutney, you know?
Yeah. Even non-Indians.
Non-Indians too.
Yeah, they're so proud of it because what I've noticed is that the secondary diaspora who has left Trinidad and went to states or UK, Europe to live from Trinidad, Guyana, or even Suriname, there's a different perspective there because I guess they miss home, they miss chutney, and even people of non-Indian origin who are part of that Caribbean diaspora in Europe, UK, and the States and Canada. They embrace chutney music.
And the lines of the Caribbean identity. The Caribbean identity is a very much a phenomenon now. And in Visham is quite correct. The NRIs, no, NRCs, non-resident Caribbean people.
Right.
They love chutney. You see Trinidadians and by extension.
So, sorry, Jason. Sorry. They love, as you correctly, because everyone who is away from heritage, they need something to remain close to their heritage. So they love, or they are also trying to globalize. Do you know that people are trying to globalize when they left Caribbean islands? Like, I don't live in Trinidad. I don't live in India, but still I'm trying to globalize that particular culture because I'm close to that heritage. So do you
have an example right here? I may have a thick Trinidadian accent, but I don't live in Trinidad. I'm living in Canada. And yes, they have really latched on to ChutneyMusic.com and even Caribbean Hindustani, who is writing songs on mainstream radio station now. It's really, people really identifying with this movement, and that is why, if we were to use numbers, go ahead.
I just wanna interject here because I also work with non-Indian artists, people not of the Indian diaspora. I have a friend who he composes for top chutney artists, and he called me, top soca artists. And he called me once and he's like, Visham, I want to put in some Hindustani in it. So how you say, shake your waist? So I say, well, let's take a Maria. And he was like, oh my God, there's an exact expression for that in Hindustani. I was like, listen, how we express ourselves in Trinidad English Creole comes from Hindustani and Patwa. So that Patwa has the equivalent to Hindustani as well. He asked me, take a joke. Take a joke is a popular thing. I was like, what was the expression? Tumka lagawe. And I was like, I said, tumka is one gesturation of a wine. And he was so amazed because he's not from an East Indian.
Education, right? Huh? They don't know how to use the language. They haven't.
But the point is when I told him, he was so completely amazed. He's like, Visham, every single Trinidad Creole expression I give you, you find in the exact expression in Hindustani. He didn't know, was aware that that was actually
Trinidad. Sadly, is one of the few Caribbean countries that only speaks one language, and this is, I have learned this as I have left. Big up to the guy, Guyanese, the Surinamese, who speak Dutch, English, and a lot of Hindi.
Bhojpuri also. The Surinamese have a large amount of Surinamese speak
Bhojpuri. And Sanantong.
Yeah, all these languages, and Trinidadians catching the tail to sing, to speak English, you know. So it's very sad over here. Now I'm learning French and Spanish, you know. And again, to tie it all together, I believe if people were to take some investment, if I'm going to be a chutney singer, a chutney, even me as a chutney promoter, right? I have learned a lot of Hindi through interacting with the subject matter, right? And because of my limited knowledge, I am able to correct people, you know? So people, they need to take a little more effort into going backwards in properly integrating what is the language, what is the proper expression.
It's important to like create a network like with the people who are trying to save their heritage, who are working toward heritage. Like, it's really important to create that strong network.
We are not so embraced. We are not embraced at all. We are seen as that kind of attitude.
I think Caribbean Hindustani and Chutney Music.com represent that.
Are doing that. Yeah, seriously, you guys are doing like researchers like me are trying to do it. So it's really important to work together and help to globalize our cultural heritage.
And many PhD students, master's students, they reach out to ChutneyMusic.com because before it had no repository for all this thing. I was recently featured in the National Periodical, and they put the caption, creating a virtual encyclopedia, and that is what ChutneyMusic.com has done, not is going to do, has done. For make it 2 years, in 2 years, and mind you, privately funded by myself alone, right? We have done all these things, it's just out of love for the thing. We want to see this thing thrive. Mm. And this is why I reached out to Visham. I looked at, well, I mean, I have an academic background, right? I mean, bright like Visham and thing, or whoever, right? Raj and them. But I have an academic background as well as I have a layman's background, right? So I could easily, like Visham will write something and it'll go over your head, right? Whereas Jayson will take it and break it down into a more palatable form. And I think that is what is being the new value proposition. Saying that, hey.
That's really great what Caribbean Hindustani and Chutney Music is doing towards their cultural heritage. And it's really great to collaborate with Visham.
We have collaborated on a lot of things, Caribbean Hindustani and ChutneyMusic.com, and we intend to do more. But again, there's an overlap because whatever ChutneyMusic.com is doing, it falls under Caribbean Hindustani because part of the Caribbean Hindustani
expression. The convenient Indo people, they need to kind of help us out in the funding area, you know, because we have a lot of expansion planned, like a radio station. Yes, there are 10, Visham said there are 10 radio stations in Trinidad, but they are mainly playing everything under the sun. Bollywood, focus, sometimes.
I think Jason and I kind of hinted on the fact that we want a more education-oriented for the sake of empowerment.
Yeah.
And I think that's what a radio station
No, you are right, Vishen, what you're saying regarding that thing.
Acha, we have around 3 minutes, so.
Yeah, no, so it's good. Yeah, Raj, you can like sum up.
All right, let's sum up everything. Yeah. Well, the meeting was very good. I'm well pleased, and I hope it was very informative. Thank you, Jason, for putting definitions and standardizing certain terms, because that's definitely needed in the various genres of chutney. There are many genres, and each genre is different and unique, and there needs to be certain parameters. So that's great. And Visham, for your information on history, and Satkriti, the questions you asked and your input is very valuable. And we learned a lot. And even myself, where I come from a family where we detest chutney, at least my grandparents, right? Or my parents, rather. But now my cousins, they love chutney. And it's just very interesting. And that has to do a lot with, I believe, with Jason's work in elevating chutney and so forth. And giving a new face to it.
Three sessions were really great. I think so. All the three sessions discussed different topics. It was really
diverse.
Interesting thing to do that.
Yes, very
thank
good.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you, guys.
And Jayson and ChutneyMusic.com, Satkriti, bahut bahut dhanbad.
Bye bye, guys.
Tere milenge.
Tere milenge. Yeah.